schizophrenic? Is anyone else feeling mentally unhinged, bouncing from elation to depression, excitement to despairing? After all, it's the time of year for new beginnings, hope-filled possibilities. Are you thinking about new teachers or about making a team? Are you cutting coupons for spiral notebooks or three-ring binders? Are you building lofts for your college-bound student? Are you driving to four stores for the must-have Wonder Woman lunchbox? Are you thinking, with the recession over and the economy coming back on track, I'll finally get my overdue raise? Is anyone else leaving work at the end of the day juiced about rolling out the 2018 stewardship campaign? How about a year-long Christian formation calendar for all ages? Maybe a big announcement on rally day about moving dirt for the long-awaited new building. Are you feeling good? Are you feeling good until you stream the national news? The headlines, the pictures, the talking heads, the competing facts, the comments under every posting, do these suck the joy out of your day, leaving you deflated? When you watch or you read or you hear about rallies and counter rallies, statues coming down, statues staying put, firings and resignations, vehicular homicide, police shootings, alt-right, anti-AF. Are you confused and appalled? Do you want to cry or cower? Do you want to march, or do you just want to make out your grocery list? Do you feel powerless? Do you want to avoid conversation with your brother-in-law, your nutty neighbor, or your delightful spouse who won't stop making his point? Do you want me to stop asking these questions because they aren't helping and you don't want to hear anymore? All you want is either peace or answers. Me too. I'm tired. I'm sick. I'm sick of this ongoing, never-ending nonsense. My head aches and my heart hurts, and I haven't a clue how to make this calamity go away. I see crazy things on the news, and I think surely we are better than this. Surely, by now, we have dealt with this division. Surely, we're over the various disappointments and can come together for the common goal of creating a good life for all our countrymen. But no, we aren't better. We're not over it. We're not coming together. It's getting worse. So we come to church, because that's where one goes for solace and answers. But even here, it's not simple. Because in this holy place, are we to seek comfort or challenge? Is the priest and the gathered community to be pastor or prophet? Do we know what we need or what God wants? Does it change week by week? Is it likely? Is it likely that we all who love each other are on the same page at the same time? Where is our help? To where do we turn? Good Lord, deliver us. And He does in His way and on His time. We learn this God's way and not my way truth from today's short psalm. In Psalm 33, God's chosen people are living in a time of heightened unrest. The favored King David had successfully brought the 12 tribes together, and a united kingdom was living in peace and in prosperity. But there was rebellion from his son Absalom, and his younger son Solomon could not hold the kingdom together. So the nation split north to south. Sound familiar? Now the people want peace. They want divisions to cease. And as they travel from towns and villages to worship God in His temple in Jerusalem, they pray. They sing. How good and pleasant it is when brothers and sisters live together in peace. It is a blessing, like the blessing of a priest when sweet-smelling oil are poured all over him at his consecration. The blessing of unified people is like the gentle rain on Mount Hermon when the snow melts and waters flow down, wetting the dry land of Zion. For it was there God set down His blessing of how we should live to be His own forevermore. God's people first sang this song, they knew His will for them. 3,000 years ago, they knew God wanted humankind to live in peace with one another. He wanted them to put down tribal, party, and ideological loyalties and find a way to coexist with compassion and equitable justice for all. 3,000 years ago, Israelite pilgrims sang God's song, prayed God's prayer, waited for God's dream to come true. 3,000 years later, we may wonder, all-powerful, all-knowing God, what's the holdup? You want the peaceable kingdom? You want the lion to lie down with the lamb? You want Jews and Gentiles, free and slaves, Slavic and Syrian, every tribe and nation, language and people to live as one? Then why aren't we? Why is the world a continuing mess? God's answer rather than formulating our rebuttal, we might discern God's response. I created the world and all that is in it. I created you, human, to be stewards of my good creation. I created you in my image, but you are not yet fully realized in my image. You are in the process of becoming what I intend for you. You are in the slow, sporadic, organisms change in inheritable physical or behavioral traits. In your case, humans, I'm looking for changes in behavioral traits. I am counting on less fear-based reactions and more tolerance, more trust of the other, the stranger yet to become the friend. I see you despair. You don't see progress. You don't see my hand at work in the process. You are wrong. There are advances. Take the long view. There is a pattern. There will be a time of struggle, and out of that struggle, new understandings will form. The human, or at least pockets of humanity, will move further into my light. They will stabilize for a while, and when ready, they will be unsettled in a time of discord. On the other side, on the other side of that discourse, they will have grown and matured and changed and advanced. Notice, human, pay attention to the slow work of your process. Dark ages followed by Renaissance. Imperialism followed by enlightenment. Slavery followed by emancipation. Resegregation followed by expanded civil rights. You are becoming. You are growing into my image. You ask, is this a dark time? A time of struggle for our nation, for our world? Yes, my beloved. You are experiencing growing pains, birthing pains, and labor is hard. What is born out of the struggle is a blessing, but the process takes a toll. You ask, how do we cope? What help do you send? Dear ones, I send perspective and presence. I am with you in this hard time, and I promise you can do this hard thing. I made you to persevere, and I give you the record. Examine the narrative, consider your human history, and you will see reasons for hope. Do not despair. I send pastors to comfort and prophets to challenge. I send saints with gifts of insight to help you see me in the mess. Do not despair. Gear up, for worse is to come. Worse will come before you see better. Be prepared to be battered about by human nonsense. But I am still with you, and I am still God. This evolution is not on you alone. Here, maybe this will help. I give you words from one of your own, an enlightened human, a man who knows dark times, an El Salvadorian priest, Oscar Marrero. Here is his prayer. A future not of our own. It helps now and then to step back and take a long view. The kingdom is not only beyond our efforts, it is beyond our vision. We accomplish in our lifetime only a fraction of the magnificent enterprise that is God's work. Nothing we do is complete, which is another way of saying that the kingdom always lies beyond us. No statement says all that could be said. No prayer fully expresses our faith. No confession brings perfection. No pastoral visit brings wholeness. No program accomplishes the church's mission. No set of goals and objectives include everything. This is what we are about. We plant the seeds that one day will grow. We water the seeds already planted, knowing that they hold future promise. We lay foundations that will need further development. We provide yeast that produces effects far beyond our capabilities. We cannot do everything. And there is a sense of liberation in realizing this. This enables us to do something and to do it very well. It may be incomplete, but it is a beginning. Step along the way, an opportunity for the Lord's grace to enter in and do the rest. We may never see the end results, but that is the difference between the master builder and the worker. We are workers, not master builders, ministers, not messiahs. We are prophets of a future.